Hello, my name is Mikko Hyppönen, and this is the F-Secure Data Security Wrap-Up of the first half of the year 2007. Year 2007 will probably be remembered as the year when Microsoft released Windows Vista, which of course will have implications to the world of data security as a whole. Vista, which is labeled as the most secure operating system ever released by Microsoft, will affect the way computer attackers will continue attacking the computer systems we have today in the use. Now, the situation right now is that if you go out and buy a brand new laptop running Vista and a brand new laptop running Mac OS X, and you take them home, you plug them online into your internet connection, they will probably both be quite safe from malware attacks with the default settings, without installing any third-party software or without changing any settings. However, this will change. Right now, in the middle of 2007, the market share still show that there's actually more users for Mac OS X than there are for Vista. And this will change. Within a year from now, some estimates think that there will be 100 million Vista users. And that changes everything. That means that there will be more and more attacks to such a common operating system. And the attackers that are currently targeting Windows XP-based systems will more and more start to target Windows Vista-based systems. Vista has also been a big challenge for software vendors to port all existing software to support Vista, and especially a big challenge for low-level software vendors, like security vendors, like antivirus companies. There's a big investment, and a lot of time has been spent in supporting this new operating system. But I guess the good news is that it's not only the software companies that have to install to have Vista support, it's also the criminals who have to port their existing XP-based malware to start to support Vista, as most of the existing malware simply won't run or won't survive a reboot under the Vista-based operating system. Vista has many built-in new security features like memory randomization, user access control or UAC, and new better built-in phishing filters and better browser. Especially the user access control feature is fairly effective in notifying the user when something malicious is happening on the system, but it can also be fairly irritating, and we do estimate that many people will turn it off, and definitely many malware will try to turn this feature off. Internet Explorer in the latest incarnation is definitely much more secure than any of the other previous versions of the software, but it still is so much targeted that we can't really recommend IE as the main browser to use. We would recommend using any other browser instead of IE. When we look at year 2007 and large virus outbreaks, the same development continues that we've seen for previous years. We see less and less real traditional viruses out there and less huge outbreaks. We did see some fairly large outbreaks caused by the so-called storm worm, where we saw the first outbreak in January 2007. And this is a family of email worms which has traditionally or typically been sent out in emails with very timely headlines. The name storm worm came from the fact that the first variants of this virus were spammed out with titles talking about a big storm in Europe, which really was going on in Europe at the time of this outbreak. We've also seen several new variants of the Varezov family, which has been around for a year and a half already. But otherwise, big outbreaks have really been missing. Most of the other activity has probably been around different bots and password-stealing trojans and banker trojans. Banker trojans like Hackstore, Torpic or Cinewall, Apophis, Snatch, and others. That's one of the big problems we have today, and that's probably one of the biggest problems we will have in the future. Now, if you look at the ways attackers have been stealing banking credentials and targeting online banks, phishing used to be the big problem, and it's definitely still out there in big numbers. But banking trojans are a much harder problem to solve. A banking trojan malware arrives to your PC through an email attachment or is dropped to your system as a drive-by download when you visit a malicious website, and then it does nothing. It just sits at your machine and waits. And then perhaps 2 or 3 weeks later, you decide to go and do some online banking, and you go to your online bank. That's when the trojan will wake up. So it's not trying to make you to go to a wrong website or fool you into doing something you're not supposed to do. It actually will wait for you to really go and do your own banking, and then it will either steal your credentials as you log into the real bank, or even worse, modify your banking transactions. You go online to pay five bills, and the trojan will insert a sixth bill, which is invisible to you in your on-screen system. It's the right URL, you used your old bookmark to go to the bank, it is SSL encrypted, there is the lock sign, everything looks normal. but you're still being hit with a banking Trojan. And this is one of the problems we think is just going to get worse in the coming years. On the PC side, we went through the 300,000 different malware thresholds during this year. On the PC side, we've now gone above 350 different examples of mobile malware. And looking at what's been happening on the mobile side, there's been an increased amount of attacks targeting mobile phones with SMS spam and SMS phishing. So text-based spam messages and even phishing scams have been found during 2007, as well as new SMS Trojans. Now, these are programs that send premium rate, expensive text messages from your phone. We found one example of these in May 2007. And once it infects your PC, which it does after you download this program, and it was made available for download on freeware, Symbian download sites. So once you run it, it starts to send a premium rate SMS every 5 seconds to an international premium rate number, which costs you $7 per message. And that money is channeled back to the virus author. We've also seen new spyware development on both Symbian Series 60 second edition phones, as well as Symbian Series 60 third edition phones. And we've even seen some spyware on the third edition phones, which has been Symbian signed. And Symbian signed is the program that was supposed to prevent problems like this, as it would vouch for the authenticity of the source of the program. We've also seen the first spyware targeting Windows mobile-based phones, which haven't been previously targeted by much malware at all, and there has not been previously any mobile phone spyware for these devices. Denial of service attacks have been an ongoing problem for more than 10 years. There's been on and off attacks in different parts of the world all along, but we really weren't expecting to see the kind of activity we saw now during the first half of 2007, where the biggest single attacks were happening in Estonia as a result of political unrest relating to the movement of a Second World War bronze statue. We saw real-world riots on the streets of Tallinn, and exactly at the same time, starting at the end of April 2007, we saw massive denial-of-service attacks against all parts of Estonian network infrastructure. These attacks were quite unique in size and scope. We've never before seen a whole country being targeted with extended periods of time of such attacks. Not just the government websites, but the side of the Prime Minister, of the President, of the House of Parliament, of local banks, of local telecommunications, being targeted with massive size of attacks, with traffic flow peaking above 4 million packets per second, which is just a huge amount of traffic targeting one single fairly small nation. And Estonia is a pretty interesting target too. It's one of the most wired countries in the world. It has, for example, done its elections, national elections, on the internet. The main communication mechanisms between the members of House of Parliament is online chat. So a nation like that, well, in a way, it's going to be hurt by network attacks more than most. But then again, they probably have more network knowledge and more means to fight such an attack than most other nations. The attacks lasted for several weeks. And we can divide the attackers to two basic groups. We have individuals who were just wanted to be part of the action, and since they couldn't be rioting on the streets of Tallinn, they did their attacks over the networks. Many of these were just normal network users, not just hackers or crackers, but really normal users who were instructed and motivated in different online chats, instructed on how to attack, what kind of commands to give from your machine, what kind of tools you could download, which websites you might want to attack, and then many people just did it. The other half of the attacks were wide-scale botnet attacks. And we don't really have much information about the background of the attacks and who were behind these attacks, but the botnet attacks were really massive in size. They could have been bought by the attackers. They are botnet operators that are selling denial-of-service attacks against any target for a few hundred dollars a day. So it's perfectly possible the botnet operators themselves were not really wanting to hurt Estonia, but they were simply doing as they were paid to. This whole phenomenon has been quite unusual, and it had other reflection attacks. We saw fairly large distributed denial of service attacks in Finland, for example, although we never could really prove that the attacks in Finland in May 2007 were connected to the attacks in Estonia at all. But one thing is for sure, that we will be monitoring what's in for the rest of the year with great interest. So thanks for watching this short snippet about what's been happening during the year 2007. Be sure to check out our blog to keep up to date about what's going to happen next. That's at fsecure.com/weblog.